is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Well, good morning, everyone. A very warm welcome to our worship this morning on this fourth Sunday in our season of Eastertide. A very warm welcome to all those who are also sharing our worship online this morning. A very warm welcome to you as well as we gather together in worship. We begin with some words of Holy Scripture from John's Gospel, chapter 11. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Alleluia. Everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Alleluia. Alleluia. We begin now with our prayer of preparation. From our few steps we share together. Almighty God,
to whom all hearts are open, all desires open, and from whom no secrets are hidden,
cleanse the thoughts of our hearts
by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit,
that we may perfectly love you
and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed for us. Let us therefore rejoice by putting away all malice and evil, and confessing our sins with a sincere and true heart. You raised the dead to life in the Spirit. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You bring pardon and peace to the broken in heart. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You make one by your Spirit the torn and divided. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
God, the Father of mercies, has reconciled the world to himself through the death and resurrection of his Son, Jesus Christ. By the ministry of reconciliation entrusted by Christ to his church, receive his pardon and peace to stand before him in his strength alone, this day and always. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, whose Son Jesus Christ is the resurrection and the life, raise us who trust in him from the death of sin to the life of righteousness, that we may seek those things which are above, where he reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
When they had made the prisoner stand in their midst, they inquired, "By what power or by what name did you do this?" Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers of the people and elders, if we are questioned today because of a good deed done to someone who is sick, and are asked how this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you and to all of the people of Israel that this man is standing before you in good health by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders. It has become the cornerstone. There is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among mortals by which we must be saved." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. this, that the Son of God laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for one another. How does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees a brother or sister in need and yet refuses help? Little children, let us love, not in word or speech, but in truth and action. And by this we will know that we are from the truth and will reassure our hearts before him whenever our hearts condemn us. For God is greater than our hearts, and he knows everything. Beloved, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have boldness before God, and we receive from him whatever we ask, because we obey his commandments and do what pleases God. And this is his commandment, that we should believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as he has commanded us. All who obey his commandments abide in him, and he abides in them. And by this we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit that he has given us. This is the word of the Lord.
I speak in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Some words from our first letter of St. John. He writes these words. Little children, let us love, not in word or speech, but in truth and action. No doubt we have all received in our letterboxes over the recent week or so lots of regional mayoral election material, and election material from every, I suppose, party in these parts that are hoping for your vote in the next couple of weeks. And there are some common themes that run through all of them. Jobs, 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 green policies, transport, housing. All, of course, commendable and important aspects of our living at this time that will be no doubt a cause for lots of debate in the hustings such as they are. We are in a difficult place coming out of the pandemic, so offering hope to us all, as politicians always like to do, is good to hear. There is, however, the old criticism that runs, well, they said X and Y when electioneering, but simply did not deliver when power was given to them. Well, we hope that our politicians will not just use words of empty rhetoric, but have truth and action in their DNA for the benefit of us all. So let's hope our politicians deliver on their promises. Now, Russia, to go a little bit sort of tangential from that theme, Russia has been in the news recently too, at the moment for different kinds of truth and action, which we do not want, of course, in our own country. I was intrigued to hear the comment from President Putin, who said, more or less, well, if you want stability, I am your man. And yet we can read dictator. But if you're looking for happy days in the future, don't hope for that. And most Russians seem to be content with the truth and action, if you like, of stability, rather than anything else. And they keep their heads down. Except, of course, if you're Mr. Navalny and others like him, who know the realities of the state against them. Truth and action, I want to explore a bit of that today. Those wonderful words from St. John. What they might mean for us, what they look like in our lives today. But back to the Acts of the Apostles first. We have an image in the reading of the Apostles hauled before a court of elders, high priests, being prosecuted for their evangelistic work. And that work was, of course, breaking down barriers, welcoming all into the fellowship of Jesus. And you have to admire the courage in those early days. They knew what truth and action really meant. They knew what happened to Jesus and might happen to them as well. But they nevertheless were driven to stand up and to be counted in their day. We hear Peter say, almost blatantly to them, that they crucified Jesus, that he was the stone rejected, but has become the cornerstone. Peter and his friends, could think about it, were living out the good news of Jesus by loving the people of Jerusalem. Not just in words or wishful thinking, but in truth and action. As we know, Stephen and the deacons were with him, were feeding the hungry, serving the poor, making a difference in their lives. And of course, which we know, spurred on the church to enormous growth in those earliest days. Now this past week we have, well, there's been such a lot in the media recently, but I want to pick up one theme this morning. That, of course, of football. We've got some avid supporters of football over here, Mr. Aston Villa in the front here. But football has been in the media for, well, lots of different reasons. But even the Prime Minister got involved with this massive issue this last week of the corporate grip of the billionaires and banks on the top football clubs in our country. It has been described as naked greed by these owners to head off into a new league for more money, whilst condemning all the other leagues into penury. It seems to be a highly destructive move with not a scintilla of thought for what might be for the good of the beautiful game itself. It does, however, reflect an ugly side, really, of our society today, and that of the corporates that have huge financial muscle, little conscience and appetite to serve the common good. Something which is, I would say, the antithesis to what we would see as a Christian ethic. Our faith is driven by love. which focuses on the other, not on ourselves. The question we ask is, what is best for you, not for me? What is best for the common good of all? And I think this is what we mean when we use those words of St. John of loving in truth and action. It's not what I get, but rather what I can give. In our passage from St. John, one of the great I am statements of Jesus, I am the good shepherd, he says. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. In Kenneth Bailey's book, The Good Shepherd, he describes that relationship between sheep and shepherd as being very close. Normally the younger member of a family would do the shepherding and have almost a personal relationship with the sheep. So when it came to protecting them from thieves or predators, they would indeed put themselves in harm's way to protect them. He explains too how the sheep get to know the voice of the shepherd. And that actually happens to this very day in country like Syria. Shepherds still go out into the wilderness with their sheep in that same kind of relationship. They know who to trust and who to follow. And of course, who not to trust and follow. And this analogy of Goodall has spoken very powerfully to all who are listening in Jesus' day. But there is a twist. Usually, it is the most junior of the family who goes out to shepherd the sheep. The job no one else wants. It is for the children almost, if you like, who get sent out. And sent out for days to find that fresh pasture. But yet Jesus is doing this work himself. Their Lord and Master is to be the shepherd. He is to put himself at risk. He is to go out and to repel the thief and the marauding predator. It is his voice that we will know and follow, in which we find that security and comfort. He will lay down his life for the sheep, for us. So there will be one flock and one shepherd. This is as John says in his letter, once again those words, love in truth and action. We see that in Jesus, our good shepherd. And this is our example to follow. Now I went through this last week, but I had an email from Dunira Sunday. Some of you might remember her. She visited here when there was a Ugandan visit to the diocese. She's from Nebbi Diocese, one of the three that we're linked with as a deanery. And we have communication now and then in email form. But she visited here, and we got to know her rather well. Well, she shared with me some news from her part of the world in northern Uganda, particularly about the troubles, of course, struggles, the loss of Bishop Alphonse, massive blow to the diocese, to COVID-19. Also, the process of finding a replacement. They're in the very midst of it at the moment. But there was a paragraph that stood out for me very powerfully. And it was about the non-appearance of the rains, which should already be there. And that they will be making preparations for famine this year. I have to say, I was quite shocked to hear the news. Uganda is normally green and flourishing. But of course, the rains don't come. That can soon turn to disaster. Just struck me that we have hardly any idea of famine, really, the devastation it can have on our lives and community. But for me, it's about climate change. That's at the heart of what's happening in Nebbi at this time and in many other parts of the world. Real people, real communities, real lives that are under threat and might be lost because of the way we live our lives in the affluent parts of the world. I think it's pretty much beyond debate that climate change is a reality and it is caused by the way we live, especially in those parts of the world in which we live in and have caused much of us. We have heard much, of course, through our Lent course this year, that the climate emergency is a reality, but we can do something about it. requires love in action and in truth and honesty. It's been encouraging to hear the efforts made by many in our own parish over this last few months, particularly the anti-plastic campaigns and the like, trying to change our lives and make it better, even in small little ways. But loving in truth and action demands much more from us individually, us as a community, country and global community. It will mean standing up for climate justice in the face of austerity, when facing the sacrifice that we will need to make. Many of us are, you can be honest, a little reluctant, but we need to stand up and face the realities that we need to learn afresh to love in truth and in action. Taking risks as a good shepherd, protecting the vulnerable as our Lord did, that's what we need to do. Protecting the vulnerable in other parts of the world, even in Mali, in Uganda. It does mean living more simply than others may simply live. Loving in truth and action means giving ourselves to the needs of others. Letting go what holds us back. Letting love for the other be our priority. And our guiding principle, as it was indeed for Jesus. This is what love means. Love in truth and action. Well, I hope the elections that come in the next few weeks will bring for us civic leaders that will have this also written into their hearts as well. That they too will help us as a city, a community, learn afresh to know what it means to live in love, in truth, and in action. Amen. We turn now to page 4 in our pieces to share together in the words of the Creed. And we say together, we believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is made.
We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Power of the Spirit and union with Christ Jesus, let us now pray to our Heavenly Father. Please be seated.
The response to Lord, lead us all, is to serve well. Lord, lead us all
to serve well.
Lord, hear us when we pray. Today we give thanks for opportunities for service in work, in rest, and in play. Be with us in the deeds we do, and let others appreciate that it is your hand at work. Help all those who lead to serve with integrity and love. We pray that they seek the common good at all times and serve well. especially in this time of mourning, who give such service to our country, Commonwealth, and the world. Lord, lead us all to serve them. Give those who serve the sick renewed strength to support anyone with physical or mental health illness. We think of those who are unwell at this time, and we pray particularly for Betty Bemmel, Bonnie, Jacqueline Hipkin, Sonia Clark, Sue Evans, Pat Johnson, Max, Mary Lewis Todd, Vic and Edna Clark, William Sloan, David Speller, June Jones, Pauline and Martin Palmer, Christopher, Peter Abraham, Jean Russell, and our ongoing prayers for Jane Kirkpatrick, Anne Collins, Mark Vivian Jones, June Hall, Sue and Jeff Evans. Be with them all at this time of need. We pray for those servants who have recently died, Carly Elliott and Martin Wilkinson. May they rest in peace and
rise in glory.
We remember those whose anniversaries of death occur this week. Daisy Brown, John Dainty, Peter James, Gabriel Lambert, Shirley Elmore, Glenn Reed, Beryl Richards, Robert Brown. We pray for their loved ones who miss them. Lord, lead us all to serve them. We pray for our friends at the Methodist Church with whom we work so closely. Guide us to serve each other well and support our local community. We pray for the Bristol South Deanery, the Area Dean, Lay Chair and the Leadership Team. And in the Anglican cycle of prayer, we consider the Nippon Sei Kokai, the Anglican Church in Japan, those who suffered persecution when the church was outlawed in the 1500s. And in more recent times, the Great East Japan earthquake, tsunami, Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant accident, all events costing many lives and subsequent hardship, but the opportunity to walk together in prayer and cooperation throughout the country of Japan and worldwide. Lord, lead us all to serve well. On this Rogation Sunday, we pray for the rains in Uganda that they may avoid severe famine. We pray for those servants who produce the food that we eat. Help each one of us to take responsibility as caretakers of your garden earth in what we consume, the goods we buy, the water we use, the journeys we make, and the actions we take. Lord, lead us all to serve you. Merciful Father, accept
these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I publish the banns of marriage between Nicholas James Russell and Christine Ann Moffat. This is now for the second time of asking. If any of you know any reason in law why these persons may not marry each other, you are to declare it now. Just a few notices for your attention this morning, really. One particularly is to do with transport to church. As you know, as we are slowly eating our way out of the pandemic, there are some normality coming back to our church life. Getting people who are a little less mobile as opposed to church on Sundays is something we want to pick up once again. And many of you know that Jenna was very much in charge of organising that rotation of different drivers and people. Well, she's now church warden, of course, and wanting to hand this on to another person who will take over the work of coordinating. So we are putting a question to all of us this morning. Are you that person who could head up maintaining and coordinating the transport rota for all those less able to get to church as it were on their own steam and need some kind of lift or help? Please have a word with the wardens and think, maybe there's something I could do. I've got some time to arrange and organise this. That's a really important part of what we do to get people to join our fellowship here, particularly after, well, in practically a year for many of these folk who've not been able to get out their front door, never mind come to church. So, really important job. If it's for you, think about it. And the world of the wardens would be delighted to hear from you. Just also to say, looking a little ahead, the APCM is coming up quite soon. Is that right, Jenna? What day is it? The
9th
of May. It's all been piggly-piggly nowadays with the APCM, but the 9th of May is on Sunday evening. I think we are planning to do a 7 o'clock start, not a 7:30 start, because we have to, as it were, have an act of worship around the annual meeting to make it fit within the rules and regulations. So it'll be a simple even song that will kick off the actual service at 7 o'clock and we'll run it into the annual parochial church meeting, as it were, and end up with a blessing and dismissal. So it'll be, if you like, everything will be totally enveloped in prayer and thanksgiving. So we'll bear that in mind. So we are limiting the numbers on agenda 2 as well for those coming to the annual meeting. So please do let us know if you would like to come into church. We hope to stream it on Zoom as well, so people at home can engage and possibly vote if they wanted to as well. That will be another way of connecting with people at home. But that's what we're hoping to do for the annual meeting in a couple of weeks' time. So if you want to be in church, please let the wardens know, book your place. Otherwise, hopefully we'll see you online for the annual meeting. Christian Avery's got to follow go, and Ken has got his t-shirt on, and he's going to tell us all about it, Ken.
Good morning. I never imagined that for the second year running, Christian Aid Week would be not as usual, but here we are. So this year, we are trying something different. We're having delivery only envelopes. So you deliver the envelopes and then the householder, hopefully, will return them to the church office. And also there will be a link there put to the Just Giving site, which is also in your pew notes, and also in the magazine for next month, which is already out and available. So we need volunteers, please, to deliver, not collect, just deliver. So I've ordered twice as many envelopes, so I'm hoping to cover twice as many streets in our patch, the village side of Fogendale Road. I will also need, eventually, people to count in a safe and secure way, masked, gloved, distanced, so volunteers for counting and a suitable time afterwards to allow the donations to be totally safe to count. It strikes me that I've walked to and from church. I will have walked twice, the 8 o'clock and the 10 o'clock, 4 miles in all, which is probably less than Rose in Kenya walks to get water when a local dam fails because of climate change, and all I have to do is turn on the tap. So, help for Christian Aid, please. And the main thing is, of course, that you donate. And if you have difficulties, please do get in touch with me. Thank you.
Thank you, Ken. Thanks very much. We come now to the piece. I invite you all out, please, to stand as we come to share the piece. The risen Christ came and stood among his disciples and said to them, "Peace be with you." Then were they glad when they saw the risen Lord. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
wants to share the peace as we prepare. Before we offer the bread and the wine, just to say that we do have a prayer tree in our church over there, and every month we hold all the prayers that have been written on the cards that have been hung on the tree. We offer it to God in the service at the end of the month. So before I say a prayer over these prayer requests, let's just hold all those folk who've been into our church over this last month, who've come and asked God for his blessing and help. Met with you and offer their prayers to you. Lord, all these prayers in this basket we offer to you now. May you hear them. Respond to those who ask for help. Strengthen, bless, and keep them in your love and peace through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for your goodness we have this bread to set before you. Which earth has given, human hands have made, it will become for us the bread of life. Blessed be God forever. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, through your goodness we have this wine to set before you. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become for us our cup of salvation. Blessed be God forever. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Almighty and Eternal Father. And in these days of Easter, to celebrate with joyful hearts the memory of your wonderful work. For by the mystery of his passion, Jesus Christ, your risen Son, has conquered the powers of death and hell, and restored in men and women the image of your glory. He has placed them once more in paradise, and opened to them the gate of life eternal. And so in the joy of this Passover, earth and heaven resound with gladness, with angels and archangels and all the powers of heaven, sing forever the hymn of your glory.
Thank you.
these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." So, Father, recalling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of thanks and praise, we bring before you this bread and this cup. We thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of Blessed Mary, Saints Peter and Paul, and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever. As our Saviour has taught us, so we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory,
forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share.
Thank you.
is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us eat the feast. Alleluia. Just before we make our way to receive communion, just remind you to follow instructions really of the wardens and science persons. Keeping your distance as you come up, so if you come up in a household group, if you are in a household group. But if you could make your way in a singular, as it were, motion around the pulpit all the way back to a seat, so to keep the mixing to a minimum. So obey those rules, that'd be wonderful. The body of Christ. Amen. To remind anyone who'd like a gluten-free wafer to come to me at the altar. There'll be two stations here. I have that in my sign. Isaiah. The Lord will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms and carry them in his bosom. Alleluia. Merciful Father, you gave your Son Jesus Christ to be the good shepherd, and in his love for us to lay down his life and rise again. Keep us always under his protection, and give us grace to follow in his steps, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And we pray together. Father of all,
we give you thanks and praise,
that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so that we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. I invite you now, please, to stand as we come to receive the blessing of Almighty God. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Actually, we've got a hymn to sing up. No, no, just, sorry, folks. Please be seated. I'll be shocked by the director of music. For the actual voluntary, which we're going to hear now from Mathias. Thank you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the eternal covenant, make you perfect in every good work, to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you, and remain with you always. Amen. Amen.
Go in peace of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia.